Right, so yeah, my name's Michael Casey. I'm the co-author, to be clear, of The Truth Machine. My co-author, Paul Vigna, who also wrote the Age of Cryptocurrency, couldn't be here today. I'm also a little disappointed. I wanted to sell some books to you guys and sign them. That didn't quite work out either, a few snafus, but I do encourage you to go and buy it. This is going to be a whirlwind look at it. I haven't done a lightning talk on this topic before, so we'll see how it goes. Basically, first of all, are we in a bubble, or is there some other sort of paradigm shift underway right now in the token market? I would argue that it's actually both. There is a significant amount of irrational exuberance. People are going to lose money. There is no doubt about that in my mind. But what really matters is that underneath it, there is this incredible paradigm shift, this new transformational technology. And like every other big shift in technology in history, there is always significant speculation. So, what is big about it? Ultimately, we are taking a centralized system of record keeping, and we're taking it from 2 millennia, basically, and turning to a decentralized system that is giving us a more reliable, real-time form of consensus. And that matters because it gives us a mechanism to come together and arrive at a common truth together to do what Yuval Harari says is the very thing that human beings did to make us rule the planet and not the bonobos. It helps us deal with this ancient problem of trust. And trust ultimately lies at the heart of everything. And it's costly because we use these centralized systems to manage cost. Give you an example of what the cost of trust is. All those skyscrapers filled with accountants reconciling one ledger to another ledger are doing it because they don't trust each other. That's an incredibly costly enterprise. And if we had a common ledger, a shared ledger that basically looked after that problem for everybody, you can imagine how much that cost would go down. So this is a big deal, everybody. Now, it's the first use case is Bitcoin. Most importantly, though, it's the first digital asset. We didn't have digital assets until Bitcoin came along because nothing in the internet world could be proven not to be replicated. The digital realm was one where anything could be copied, so there was no such thing as an asset. And that's really important because now we can take systems of real value, other markers of value in the outside world, and give them this digital representation. And in that digital representation, we can do the really cool things that software and programmability allow us to do. So we can start to manage our value and our economic systems with the power of software. Most importantly, we have this concept of programmable currency. So rather than the analog money of dollars and other fiat currencies and gold and so forth that has a kind of a neutral and agnostic take, this money can do things. It has the power of programmability. So we can embed into that currency the ability to do whatever it is that we would like it to do. We can turn on a device, or we can trigger a derivative, or we can initiate a work process. This is a really powerful and useful concept. I think that ultimately we could actually tackle the tragedy of the commons. This is a very profound and deep seated problem for humanity generally. It stems from an essay by an ecologist called Garrett Hardin, who argued that he was talking about cow herders who couldn't manage or commonly manage their common grassland, who argued that self-interest always trumped public interest, and as a result, our public resources would get destroyed unless we had external government to look after that. But if you think about what Bitcoin is, here you have these miners who are acting entirely in their self-interest, pursuing profit, they're pursuing bitcoins, but at the same time, they are simultaneously maintaining a common public ledger, a public resource, the blockchain. And as a result, they are they're resolving this tragedy of the commons. I think that concept can be applied very broadly, and it's the reason really why the token economy is exciting. We can get interested in all the money that's being raised, but most importantly, this idea of utility, that we can embed incentives to look after our common resources and our common objectives and have multiple coins is the most important thing. I do wish that this utility token notion is not going to be killed, by the way, by the SEC. A lot of important work being done there, but they need to be aware of the significance of this new economic breakthrough that a utility token represents. So I see this as a community concept, that basically with the power of this form of embedded programmable money, we can have exchange, the medium exchange, be the governance of what communities want. We can have efficient resource management as a community goal. Ultimately, tokens are going to be the vehicles through which we look after and resolve many of the problems we have in terms of efficiency and environmental management. And it's ultimately an entirely new form of money. We can start to take these tokens, embed our values into them, and effectively turn them into a form of social capital rather than this fetishized thing that dollars and yen and euros currently represent to people. Ultimately, I would argue, hopefully, bringing us to a more harmonious society. I know that's a very utopian way of thinking about it, but maybe Brinkley will come back out now. We'll have a fireside chat, and he can drill down and see whether there's some skepticism that should be brought into this. Thank you very much.